things in compared to its cost. So we can conclude that in the dynamic world of companies, customers and competitors, business can gather valuable insights through applications of various marketing research methods. Marketing research is used for understanding customer needs and market trends. They can be used to track customer behavior, gauge brand perception, monitor product use, identify problems, and inform strategic decisions. So, in this session, we have discussed the scope of marketing research, exploring its reach across various aspects of business, analyzes the role of marketing research in the marketing mix. We describe the key applications of marketing research, understanding how it informs business decisions, and evaluated the role of marketing research in identifying and strengthening the firm's competitive advantage. We also explained how marketing research contributes to building and maintaining strong customer relationship through databases and targeted marketing. Now, you can check your progress by answering these questions. The first question is, which of the following is the primary purpose of the problem identification research in marketing? The options are to develop solutions for existing marketing problem. Second option is to identify potential future problems in the market. Third is to test the effectiveness of marketing campaigns. And the fourth option is to understand customer buying habits. The second question is, market research that analyzes historical sales data and consumer trends to predict future sales falls under the category of option A is problem solving research, option B is segmentation research, option C is market position research, and option D is pricing strategy research. The third question is, a company conducts a survey to identify different customer segments within their target market. This research is most likely classified as option A is product development research, B is sales forecasting research, option C is market segmentation research, and option D is pricing strategy research. Question 4 is, a study is conducted to assess the effectiveness of a new advertising campaign for a soft drink. This is an example of option A is problem identification research, B is problem solving research, C is market share analysis research, D is brand positioning research. Question 5 is, the main purpose of customer satisfaction research is to, option A, attract new customer, B is track the success of ad campaigns, C is measure customers' sentiment towards a company's offering, and D is develop targeted marketing campaign. Question 6 is, why is regular customer satisfaction tracking is important? Option A is to compare satisfaction levels to competitor data, B is to identify the most effective marketing channels, C is to analyze the impact of events or changes on customer perception, D to create a customer database for direct marketing. Question 7 is, customer databases are valuable for direct marketing because they help companies to, option A, track customer satisfaction over time, option B is develop a one-size-fits-all marketing strategy, C is personalized promotions for specific customer segments, and option D is gain awareness of new marketing trends. Question number 8 is, which of the following is not a benefit of customer database marketing? Option A is increased customer retention, B is reduced marketing cost, C is more relevant marketing messages, and D is all of the above are benefits. Question number 9 is, how can customer databases be used to personalize promotions? The option A is by segmenting customers based on their interest, B is by offering discounts to loyal customers, C by recommending products that customers are likely to be interested in, and option D is all of the above. The last question number 10 is, what is one way to measure the success of a customer database marketing campaign? Option A is by tracking the number of website visitors, option B by measuring customer satisfaction, option C by tracking the return on investment, and option D is all of the above. You can check your answers with this given answers. So with this, we end this session. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Any issues requiring financing?
For these sources, what is the cost of financial for raising these funds through financial institutions. What innovation can be made in raising funds?
ये ऑडियो पता नहीं क्यों कम जा रही है उधर.
Market. Why? Because then only you could just ascertain the availability. Financing decisions are primarily concerned with the capital structure or debt equity composition, an important benchmark. Our next decision is dividend policy decision. What kind of dividend you want to just allocate to your shareholders? First, we have to just look at the earning, then we have to just look at the retained earnings, then we have to just look at the policy, then we have to just look at the future exigencies, and then we are just thinking of declaring the dividend to the existing shareholders. Dividend policy decision decides.
ये लाइव में ऑडियो सही क्यों नहीं जा रही? इसकी पता नहीं क्यों लौट के वापसी आ रही है.
ये वाला ये वाला
हाँ हाँ ऑडियो ऑडियो आवाज कम आ रही है.
अरे
कुछ गड़बड़ हो गया.
अरे उल्टा ऑन कर रखे है ना.
टू ओके Prudent finance manager takes dividend decision in the light of the investor's preferences, liquidity position of the firm, and stability of the earning of firm, need to repay debt, restrictions in debt contracts, access to capital market, etc. Our next point is dividend policy decision is integral part of financing decision. Okay. So whatever you are just getting the funds through financing decision, you must be ready for the next course of action to allocate the part of profit to these investors. What is the interrelationship amongst these decisions? The interrelationship between these three types of financial decision centers on the following issues. Which decision comes first, investment or financing? In reality, two decisions are in simultaneous. In fact, neither decision by itself makes sense without the other. There would be no financing decision to make in the absence of investment decisions and vice versa. If you have the investment plan, you must have the financing decisions as well. But if you have the financing plans, you must have the investment decisions as well. Next is investment decision versus financing decision, fundamental difference. What is the fundamental difference? Typically, a financing decision involves accepting cash today from the capital market and repaying the same together with interest or dividend subsequently over a period of time. Outflows. On the other hand, an investment decision involves investing in cash today in the product market outflow and receiving a stream of earnings inflow subsequently. Now, the cash invested in the product market is in fact the cash which is raised from the capital market. Our next point is relationship through NPV. Usually it is extremely cumbersome, though not impossible to match the cash flows arising from the financing decisions and the cash flow accruing from the investment decisions over a period basis on account of the possible mismatch between their timings. Like we have just seen earlier, which decision should come first? It may be simultaneous. So which is first and this which is the second one? They are following each other. So definitely there will be a time gap as well. It is therefore for simpler to capture the financing cash flows through their cost of capital and to use this rate for discounting the operating cash flows. Under this framework, obtaining a positive net present value implies the same thing as minimize the cost of capital. Wealth maximization and maximization of profit pool objectives. In a highly competitive environment, financial objectives of a firm should be set within the framework of corporate objectives of sustainable competitive edge. As such, wealth maximization objective has come to be widely recognized criteria with which the performance of a business enterprise is evaluated. The word wealth refers to the net present worth of the firm, and the net present worth is the difference between gross present worth and the amount of capital investment required to achieve the benefits. After wealth maximization, we have to have the value maximization is also. So it is the indirect route. The value maximization is the wealth maximization. In the final analysis, shareholders seek to maximize their return for a given level of risk or minimize their risk for a given level of return. Objective of maximization of profit pool. What are the main highlights of this objective? Profit pool concept is based on the concept of looking beyond the core business. Shape of a profit pool reflects the competitive dynamics of a business. Profit considerations emanate from actions and interactions of companies and customers. A profit pool is not stagnant. It is not stagnant. A profit pool map answers the most pertinent question. What is that? Where and how is money being made? Profit pool may prompt the management to examine how same profit sources exert influence over others and shape competition. Imagine all these objectives of maximization of profit pool are separate marbles to be included for maximization of profit. Other objective and value maximization objective. There are many other objectives which are assumed to complete with the value maximization objective. In fact, there are whole lot of researchers who interview practicing manager and show that the manager often have a whole of other legitimate objectives other than VMO, that is value maximization objective. These are often enumerated as maximizing return of investment, maximizing profits after tax, maximizing sales, maximizing the market share of their products, and so on. Let us just look at net present value rule. The NPV rule really provides you with a simple way of making that comparison by computing the present value of an investment. You are finding out what the investment is worth today. On comparing the present value of an investment with its initial outlay, you arrive at the net present value, which may be positive and which may be positive or negative, as the case may be. Okay. Let us look at the cardinal principles of financial decision. A financial manager, in his attempt to maximize corporate value of the firm, must keep in view the following basic consideration while making financial decisions. First one is strategic principle. According to this principle, financial decisions of a firm should be tethered to the overall corporate objectives and strategies. Optimization principle. Thrust of financial decision should be an intensive use of available funds, and for that purpose, proper balance between the fixed and working capital should be sought. Risk return principle. Maintaining suitable balance between the risk and return is the crux of financial decision making. How? Because it should not be too risky, it should not be too liberal. Given the product market strategy, return and risk are the function of decision making. To the size of firm, kinds of asset to be acquired, type of funds to be employed, extent of funds to be kept in liquid form, etc. Next is marginal principle. According to this principle, a firm should continue to operate up to the point where its marginal revenue is just equal to its marginal cost. So, a break-even point. Suitability principle. Focus on this principle is on creating an asset by a financial instrument of the same approximate maturity. Our next principle is flexibility principle. According to this principle, financial plan of a firm should be capable to being changed in sync with changing environment. And finally, the timing principle. Friends, timing should be crucial consideration in financial decisions. Investment and financing decisions should be taken at a time that enables the organization to seize market opportunities and minimum cost of raising funds. Our next topic is time value of money. The time value of money is again a crucial factor. The time value of money or time preference for money is one of the central idea is finance. Money has time value because of the following reasons. Individual generally preferred current consumption. An investor can profitably employ a rupee received today to give him a higher value to be received for tomorrow. Future is uncertain, that you have to admit, accept. Inflationary pressures make the money received in future of lesser purchasing power. Inflationary pressure make the money received in future of lesser purchasing power. Thus, there is preference of having money at present than at a future point of time. This automatically means that a person will have to pay in future more for a rupee received today. A person may prefer to accept less today for a rupee received in future. They are called as compounded value and discounted value. Let us look at them little in little detail. The compounded value the process of finding the future value of a payment or received or series of payments or receipts when applying the concept of compound interest is known as compounding. It is also called terminal value. This we are just talking about the compound value of your payment or receipt. Now let us just speak about the discounted value. In case of discounted value, we estimate the present worth of the future payment, installment or series of payments adjusted for the time value of money. Friends, in the discounted value, what do? We estimate the present worth of future payment, installment or series of payment adjusted for the time value of money. Let us look at the determination of implied interest rates, implied principal amount, and their annuities. Determination of implied interest rates. Suppose you borrow rupees 100 for 1 year and the lender asks you to repay 120 1 year later. What is the interest rate implied by your borrowing? Clearly 20%, because you have to pay 20 rupees extra after 1 year. This is because that at the end of 1 year, you are required to prepay the principal of rupees 100 as well as the interest of rupees 20. All right, friends, determination of implied principal amount. Let us assume that a prospective borrower approach you for a loan. He is confident of being able to pay you rupees 193 for 4 years, starting a year from today. Now, assuming that your desired rate of interest is 20% per annum, how much amount would you be prepared to lend him today? In the light of our discussion above, it should be clear that the amount you should lend should exactly equal to the present value of annual stream of rupees 193 for 4 years, discounted at the rate of 20%. Mathematically, if we just look at, let us assume that the amount you would be prepared to lend is P. So how it comes out to be? 193, 1.2, because 20%, and then it is raised to power 2. Same thing is raised to power 3. Same thing is raised to power 4. So we get 500 rupees which you invest 2 years or 4 years back. Now, if you pay 193 every year, you are going to give the base amount today is 500. Determination of annuities. Let us assume that you borrow rupees 100 at an interest of 20% per annum for a period of 2 years. However, you wish to repay the loan in two equal annual installments, also known as annuities. So what should be these installment? If your answer is 50, it is obviously wrong. Guess why? Let us assume that each installment amount equals X. So we have a cash flow pattern of the kind plus 100 in time 0, x at the end of 1 year and x at the end of 2nd year respectively. According to the IRR rules, we must have 100 is equal to x . So let us assume that each installment amount equals x. So we have a cash flow pattern of this kind plus 100 in time 0, x at the end of 1st year and x at the end of 2nd year respectively. So according to IRR rule, we must have, let us just look at the formula mathematically, 100 x within bracket 1.2 plus x within bracket 1.2 raised to power 2, or the annuity value 100 is equal to 8.833 x plus 0.694 x, or if we simplify it, 100 by 1.527 is equal to 65 rupees 49 paisa. Okay, 65 rupees 49 paisa. Now what are the basic factors influencing long-term financial decisions? External factors. The external factors refer to environmental factors that bear upon operations of a business enterprise. These factors are beyond the control and influence of management. The following external factors enter into long-term financial decisions making process: state of economy, phase of trade cycle, institutional structures of capital market, developed or underprivileged, underdeveloped, state regulations in financing, debt equity norms, dividend payment restrictions, etc. Taxation policy, expectations of investor in terms of safety, liquidity and profitability. And the sixth point is lending policies of financial institutions. If we just look at the internal factors, the internal factors comprise those factors which are related with internal condition of the firm as listed below: nature of the business, size of the business, age of the firm, ownership structure, asset structure of the firm, liquidity position of the firm, expected return, cost and risk, probabilities of regular and steady earning, attitude of management. Our next unit is cost of capital. The cost of capital is an important financial concept. It links the company's long-term financial decisions with the shareholders' value as determined in the marketplace. There are two basic conditions must be fulfilled so that the company's cost of capital can be used to evaluate new investment. Two things: the new investment being considered have the same risk as the typical or average investment undertaken by the firm. The financing policy of the firm remains unaffected by the investments that are being made. So two phases, either typically risky or unaffected by any dislocation. What is the concept of cost of capital? The following are the basic characteristics of cost of capital. cost of capital is really a rate of return. It is not a cost as such. We call it cost of capital, but then we are just considering the rate of return on the capital. A firm's cost of capital represents minimum rate of return that will result in at least maintaining, if not increasing, the value of its equal share, of its equity shares. Cost of capital as a rate of return is calculated on the basis of actual cost of different components of capital. It is usually related to long-term capital funds. In operational terms, cost of capital in terms of rate of return is used as discounted rate. Used to discount the future cash inflows so as to determine their present value and compare it with the investment outlay. Now, cost of capital has three components. One is return at zero risk level, premium for business risk, and premium for financial risk. Component of cost of capital. A firm cost of capital comprises three components. Once again, return at zero risk level. This refers to expected rate of return when a period involves no risk, whether business or financial. For reference purpose, return on sovereign bonds, government securities is taken as risk-free rate. Okay. Purchasing power risk arises due to changes in purchasing power of money. And the liquidity risk, money rate risk, means the risk of an increase in future interest rates. And liquidity risk means the ability of a supplier of funds to sell his shares, debentures, bonds quickly. Classification of cost of capital. Explicit cost and implicit cost. If you just look at nutshell, explicit cost relate to raising of funds, while implicit cost relate to uses of funds. Average cost and marginal cost. The average cost is the weighted average of the cost of each component of funds. After ascertaining cost of each source of capital, appropriate weights are assigned to each component of capital, whereas the marginal cost of capital is the weighted average cost of new funds raised by the firm. Marginal. The next margin, right? Future cost of capital refers to the unexpected cost of incurred in raising new funds. While historical cost represents cost of capital incurred in the past in procuring funds for the firms, in financial decision making, future cost of capital is relatively more relevant. Then comes the specific cost and combined cost. The cost of individual component of capital are specific cost of capital. The combined cost of capital is the average cost of capital as it is inclusive of cost of capital from all sources. In capital budgeting decisions, combined cost of capital is used for accepting, rejecting the investment proposal. Now, how could you just compute the cost of capital of individual components? Computing of cost of capital from individual sources of funds helps in determining the overall cost of capital for the firm. There are four basic sources of long-term funds for a business firm. First, the long-term debt and debentures. Second one is preference share capital. And the third one is equity share capital. When you have just have all the funds from outside, the retained earnings are the internal funds which you earn out of profits. Though not all of these sources may be tapped by the firm for funding its activity, each firm will have some source of funds in its capital structure. The specific cost of each source of funds is after tax cost of financing. Cost of long-term debt, the first one, or debentures. The cost of long-term debt represents the minimum rate of return that must be earned on debt financed investment if the firm value to remain intact. Long-term debt may be issued at par, at premium, or discount. But now it may be perpetual or redeemable. The formula for computing the cost of long-term debt at par is KD 1 minus TR, where KD is cost of long-term debt, T is marginal tax rate, and R is debenture interest rate. Where KD is cost of long-term debt, T is marginal tax rate, R is debenture interest rates. 1 minus T is also known as tax shield, since interest paid on debt is a tax deductible expense. This effectively brings down the real cost of debt. In case the debentures are issued at premium or discount, the cost of the debt should be calculated on the basis of net proceeds realized. For computing cost of redeemable debt, the period of redemption is considered. The cost of long-term debt is the investor's yield to maturity adjusted by the firm's tax rate plus distribution cost. The question of yield to maturity arises only when the loan is taken either at discount or at premium. In case of underwriting and other issuing cost, they are adjusted in the same way as discount is being adjusted in net proceeds and other calculations. If we just look at the cost of preference capital, the cost of preference capital represents the rate of return that must be earned on preferred stocks financed investment to keep the earning available for residual stockholders unchanged. Cost of preference shares can be estimated by dividing the cost of capital by dividing the dividend stipulated per share by the current market price of the share. So how could you calculate the cost of preference capital? This is equal to dividend divided by face value minus issue cost. Cost of equity capital. Cost of equity capital. Friends, it is little cumbersome, difficult, so as to say. Cost of equity capital is by far the most difficult to measure because of the following reasons. The cost of equity is not the out-of-pocket cost of using equity capital. The cost of equity is based upon the stream of future dividends as expected by shareholders. Very difficult to estimate. The relationship between the market price with earning is known. Dividends also affect the market value. Which one is to be considered? The following are the approaches to computation of cost of equity capital. EP ratio, earning price ratio. The cost of equity capital is measured by earning price ratio. If we add the growth rate also, so it would be EP ratio plus growth rate method. This method considers growth in earning. The next one is DP ratio, dividend price ratio method. Cost of equity capital is measured by dividend price ratio. And if we add once again the growth rate method, it will be DP plus growth rate method. The method is comparatively more realistic as it considers future growth in dividend. And it considers the capital as appreciation as well. This method is based on the assumption that the value of a share is the present value of all anticipated dividends, which it will give over an infinite time horizon. The firm is here viewed as a going concern with an infinite life. Realized yield method, one of the difficulties in using DP ratio and EP ratio for finding out KE is to estimate the rate of expected return, as this method depends on the rate of return actually earned by the shareholders. Next is securities beta method. The use of beta to measure the cost of equity capital is definitely a better approach. The major reason is that the method incorporates risk analysis, which other methods do not. However, its application remains limited, perhaps because it is tedious to calculate the beta value. Our next is cost of retained earning. Cost of retained earning. Friends, the corporate managers and some analysts normally consider the funds retained in the firm as cost-free funds because it does not cost anything to the firm to make use of a part of its earning not distributed to the shareholder. But this is not true. It definitely costs the shareholder something, and this is an opportunity cost representing sacrifice of the dividend income which the shareholders would have otherwise received it and invested the same elsewhere to earn a return thereon. Thus, the minimum cost of retained earning is the cost of equity capital, KE. weighted cost of capital is also known as composite cost of capital. Overall cost of capital or weighted marginal cost of capital is the average of the cost of each sources of funds employed by the firm, properly weighted by the proportion they hold in the capital structure of the firm. Now let us just see what is the significance of cost of capital. The determination of the firm's cost of capital is important. Why? Because the cost of capital provides the very basis for financial appraisal of new capital expenditure proposals and thus serves as acceptance criteria for capital expenditure project. Cost of capital helps the manager in determining the optimal capital structure of the firm. Cost of capital serves as the basis for evaluating the financial performance of top management. Cost of capital also helps in formulating dividend policy and working capital policy. Cost of capital can serve as capitalization rate, which can be used to determine capitalization of a new firm. Some misconception about cost of capital. The cost of capital is a central concept in financial management, linking the investment and financing decision. A few misconceptions in this regard are as follows. The concept of cost of capital is academic and impractical, which is not. It is equal to the dividend rate, precisely never. Retained earnings are either cost-free or cost significantly less than external equity. These are neither cost-free or the cost significantly less than the external equity is once again may or may not. Depreciation has no cost. Depreciation has no cost, whereas depreciation is a kind of amortization, is a kind of reduction of the value of the asset, which is properly been shown in the profit loss account and properly been reduced from the assets of the balance sheet. The cost of capital can be defined in terms of an accounting based manner. No. How? It will not be in the accounting based manner because it has got the market base, it has got the policy based, it has got the other circumstances, it has got the cash availability, the fund availability, it has got the investment policy of the organization and other relevant factors in an organization. And the last misconception about cost of capital is, if a project is heavily financed by debt, its weighted average cost of capital is low. Again, depends. If a project is heavily financed by debt, its weighted average cost of capital is low. Because if it is deflation, definitely you will have a different value. But if it is inflation, the debts, interest rate would also be high, and so the financing decisions, their cost of capital will be low in exceptional circumstances. According to the size of the firm, according to the capacity of the firm to raise the funds, according to the policy of the firm concerned, and according to the economy status. Friends, with that, we have completed our first session of MMPF 002. In the coming weeks, we'll be having the next sessions of MMPF 002, which is a course of financial management of the revised Masters in Business Administration. Thank you.